In the last video, we studied Hermitian operators and matrices, and we discovered that Hermitian matrices had real eigenvalues and orthogonal eigenvectors, and we claimed that they were diagonalizable. In this video, we're going to prove that they are diagonalizable, and we're going to do it three ways. The first is using power vectors. So suppose that we had a Hermitian operator that's not diagonalizable. Then there isn't a basis of eigenvectors, but there's always a basis of power vectors. Every matrix admits a basis of power vectors. So you should be able to find some power vectors that aren't eigenvectors. So let's suppose that X is a power vector of degree 2. You always have to have some of those, because if you have a power vector of degree 3, then you hit it with L minus lambda times the identity and it becomes a power vector of degree 2. So if you have a power vector of degree 2, then you have that L minus lambda times the identity squared acting on the vector gives you 0, but L minus lambda times the identity acting on the vector does not give you 0. On the other hand, the adjoint of L minus lambda times the identity is L dagger minus lambda bar times the identity. And L dagger is L, and lambda bar is lambda because it had real eigenvalues. So we can look at 0 as the inner product of, you see, this vector is 0, so you dot x into it and you still get 0. But now you can take one of these lambda minus L minus lambda times the identity and put it on the other side. You have to dagger it, but you can put it on the other side. And then you notice that L dagger is L, and lambda times the identity dagger is lambda times the identity, because lambda was real. And now we have the inner product of L minus lambda times the identity x with itself. Well, that's the length of L minus lambda times the identity x squared, and that's not 0. So we just showed that 0 was equal to a number that's not 0. So something must have gone wrong. And what went wrong was the assumption that there was a power vector of degree 2. What we've proven is that if L is diagonalizable, then there are no power vectors of degree 2. And if there are no power vectors of degree 2, there are no power vectors of degree bigger than 2. And so all power vectors are actually eigenvectors. And since there's always a basis of power vectors, there's a basis of eigenvectors. And so our matrix was diagonalizable. Now, if you don't like power vectors, we can prove that it's diagonalizable by perturbation. We know that if you take any matrix, you can bump it a little bit to turn it into a matrix whose eigenvalues are all different. And if the whose roots of the characteristic polynomial are all different, and then it'll automatically be diagonalizable. So let's perturb H. So H is our matrix, H for Hermitian, that equals its conjugate. And let's perturb it a little bit to get something with distinct eigenvalues. But since this is Hermitian, the eigenvectors of H epsilon are orthogonal. And now we take a limit as the perturbation gets smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. The eigenvectors of H epsilon in the limit become eigenvectors of H. And because they're orthogonal, in the limit they stay orthogonal. And they can't collapse in on themselves. You see, if you had a matrix that wasn't Hermitian, like this one, then you might get two eigenvectors, and the limit of this one might be the same as the limit of this one. But that can't happen with Hermitian guys, because if you have two things that are orthogonal, the limit of one of them can't be the same as the limit of the other. The limits have to be orthogonal. So that's our proof by perturbation. The third proof is by induction, and that's the proof that I give in the book. So the claim is that all n by n Hermitian matrices, or equivalently, all Hermitian operators on an n-dimensional vector space, are diagonalizable, and we do it by induction on n. So the first thing we have to do is the base case. Is it true for n equals 1? Well, sure, and a 1 by 1 matrix is just a number. It's already diagonal. There's nothing but a diagonal on a 1 by 1 matrix. And so next, we assume that it's true for k by k matrices, and we have to prove it for k plus 1 by k plus 1 matrices. So let's suppose that we have a k plus 1 by k plus 1 matrix. It's got some characteristic polynomial, and the characteristic polynomial has to have at least one root, so there's always at least one eigenvalue, and every eigenvalue has at least one eigenvector. So you can always find an eigenvector with some eigenvalue. And then you can find a basis that extends this. You pick vectors b2 so that b1 and b2 are linearly independent, and b3 so that b1, b2, and b3 are linearly independent. You pick a bunch of linearly independent vectors so that b1 through bk plus 1 is a basis. It's not an orthogonal basis. They're not eigenvectors except for the first guy, but it's a basis. Then you take that basis and you apply Gram-Schmidt to it. So you apply Gram-Schmidt to it, and you turn it into an orthonormal basis. But remember what Gram-Schmidt does to the very first vector. It doesn't change it any, except maybe to rescale it. So we wind up with an orthonormal basis where the first vector is an eigenvector, and the rest probably aren't. But we've got one eigenvector, and it's an orthonormal basis. And now we ask what the matrix of H looks like in the orthonormal basis. Well, if we apply H to D1, because it's an eigenvector, you get lambda 1D1, and its coordinates in the D basis just wind up being lambda 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. Well, that means that if you look at the matrix of H in the D basis, the first column is what we just did, and the rest of the columns, I have no idea what the rest of the columns are doing, because I have no idea what the rest of the D's are doing. But we get something that looks like the first column is lambda 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, and then I'm going to write the rest as a block. There's a row, which I'll call B, and then a smaller matrix that I'll call C. But hold on. H was equal to its own conjugate, and our basis was orthonormal. And that means that if you want to know the matrix of H, well, that's the same thing as the matrix of H dagger, because H and H dagger are the same. And that's the same thing as the dagger of the matrix of H. That is to say, it's the matrix of H transpose conjugate. So if you take the matrix that we already got and take its transpose conjugate, you get a zeros upstairs and a B dagger over here, and C dagger over here, and lambda bar over here. Well, the only way that the matrix of H can be this and this is if lambda 1 is real, so it's equal to its own conjugate. Well, we already knew the eigenvalues had to be real. And if B is 0, and if C is equal to its own conjugate. So the matrix of A has to be a lambda 1 in the corner, zeros here, and then a C downstairs. In other words, it's block diagonal. We have a 1 by 1 block and a K by K block. And what's more, the K by K block is equal to its own transpose conjugate. Oh, but we assumed that all K by K matrices that were Hermitian were diagonalizable. So C is diagonalizable. And once we diagonalize C, we can take the eigenvectors, pad them with zeros, and get eigenvectors of H. So since this corner is diagonalizable, since it's 1 by 1, and this corner is diagonalizable, the whole matrix is diagonalizable. And if the matrix is diagonalizable in the B basis, the operator is diagonalizable. And that's our theorem. Now, one last thing. We learned that if you have a Hermitian matrix, then it's diagonalizable, has real eigenvalues, and you can find an orthogonal or orthonormal basis of eigenvectors. I claim that if you can find a matrix that's diagonalizable, has real eigenvalues, and has an orthogonal basis of eigenvectors, then it's automatically Hermitian. So these three properties completely characterize Hermitian matrices. And here's the proof. Suppose its diagonalizable has real eigenvalues and an orthogonal basis of eigenvectors. By scaling, we can make it into an orthonormal basis of eigenvectors. And since they're eigenvectors, the matrix of H and the B basis is diagonal. Well, let's figure out what the matrix of H dagger is. The matrix of H dagger, since we're working in an orthogonal orthonormal basis, is a matrix of A transpose conjugate. Well, taking the transpose of a diagonal matrix is easy. It doesn't do anything. And conjugating a bunch of real numbers is easy. That doesn't do anything either. So if you take the transpose conjugate of this matrix, you just get this matrix back again. In other words, the matrix of H dagger is the same as the matrix of H. Well, if two operators have the same matrices, they must be the same operator. So H dagger equals H.